A very good afternoon to all the students who are present today for yet another lecture of third year BCom semester 5 for the subject business administration. I warmly welcome one and all. Now students, you have been attending number of lectures in BA and you are already aware that we have discussed and completed the first three chapters of unit 1. That is to say, we have understood financial management. Number 2, we have understood financial planning. And number 3, we also understood capitalization. In the previous few lectures, we have been discussing all about capital and capitalization, as to what do you mean by capitalization. We studied the different forms of it, namely overcapitalization and undercapitalization. In the previous lecture, I also summed up the discussion by giving you a comparative idea between over and under capitalization. So I hope that you are very well clear with all what we have studied up till now. That is to say, if I give you a quick recap, when I said number 1, financial management, it was all about managing finance in such a manner that it is acquired at a minimum cost. Thereby, it is used optimally. On the other hand, number 2, when we studied about financial planning, it also dealt with two things. That was estimating the fund requirements and thereby decide from what sources will you raise the necessary finance. While number 3, capitalization, we discussed that it was actually the sum total of capital that has been invested in the business. The total capital with which the business can run smoothly was nothing but capitalization. So now it brings me to the fourth chapter, the fourth aspect of Unit 1 that talks all about capital structure. Very much similar to what we did earlier, but let me give you a simple example for the same. Now, students, in financial plan, you discussed two aspects. First, being deciding the fund requirement as to how much finance is to be raised or is required. Secondly, we discussed as to from which sources would you raise the necessary finance. So the first aspect, that was all about total fund requirement, was nothing but capitalization that you already did in the previous lectures. But the second aspect of a financial plan, that is to decide the securities, the sources from where the fund would be raised, is nothing but capital structure. So in simple words, if I say the structure of various sources of capital is nothing but a capital structure. We have discussed in capitalization all about the total capital that is required in the business. But from where would that capital be raised, or what actually forms up capital, would be explained by capital structure. So in simple words, it is just a structure showing the sources from where the capital has been raised. Not only that, it will also show us the proportion of each source in the total capital structure. So students, if I give you a simple meaning of capital structure, according to Justin Berg, capital structure of the company refers to the makeup of its capitalization. The most simplest definition, if I can give you, is that capital structure is the makeup of capitalization. Now, what we have studied about capitalization was that it is the total capital that is invested in the business required to run the business smoothly. But if we talk about the makeup or the structure of that capital, as to what has been comprised into that, or from where has that money been raised, in what proportion it has been raised, it is nothing but capital structure. That is to say, in other words, the type of securities to be issued, as to from which securities money will be raised, from what sources money would be raised, and the relative proportion of each type of security in the total capitalization. So I can say, when you break up that capitalization and it shows you the different securities from where the fund has been raised, its proportion in capitalization is nothing but capital structure. So I hope that you are clear with the simple definition of capital structure. the structure of your capital, the securities showing you from where the money has been raised, and its proportion is capital structure. But when we are talking about that capital structure is the makeup of capitalization, or it is showing us the type of securities from where money has been raised, it brings us to another question as to what could be these securities from where finance is raised, or the capital structure comprises of which securities. So this we already discussed in previous chapter as well, that funds could either be the owner's funds or they could be the borrowed funds, meaning to say the securities from where fund has to be raised could either be the ordinary share capital, meaning to say the equity share capital, or it could also be the preference share capital, could be debentures, could be bonds, could be a loan taken from the bank or any other financial institution. When we talk about shares, the company has to pay dividend to those shareholders because they have invested their hard-earned money in the business. Again, when I talk about shares, dividend was paid at a fixed rate to the preference shareholders. They were given a preference over other shareholders and other liabilities for the payment of dividend. But on the other hand, it was not compulsory to pay dividend to the equity shareholders. Rather, they shall be paid dividend only when surplus was left after all the other payments were made. Secondly, if we talk about the borrowed funds such as debentures, a fixed interest has to be paid onto them. A fixed rate of interest was the burden when debentures are used to raise the finance. So as a company, it has to decide whether funds will be raised from the own funds or whether it will be raised from the borrowed funds, because the organization has to make a good use of all different kind of securities, thereby also maintaining a balance between them. When it tries to raise funds more from preference shares or debentures or other borrowed funds, it will definitely lead to increased financial burden onto the company, because these things have a fixed payment of interest and dividend respectively. So the company has to decide as to what shall be the sources, the securities, and what shall be its proportion to raise the desired funds. So I hope that you are clear with the definition of capital structure. You can have a look at the above slide also that shows you how the capital structure looks like. If this entire part is capitalization, that is to say, if this entire part shows you the total capital in a business unit, these parts divided shows you the structure of this capital, that is to say the capital structure. It shows the makeup of capitalization. It shows the different securities from where this capital has been raised. Could be a major chunk of equity share capital, could be the preference share capital, could be the debt, that is to say some debentures, bonds or loans, and could be the other sources of finance or capital. So this could be a diagrammatic representation of how a capital structure looks like. Simply, you need to understand that when we say how much capital was required, that was something capitalization we studied in the previous chapter. But when we say from where it will be acquired, from what sources will it be raised, it is nothing but capital structure. One more diagram where you can see alternative sources of funds, that is to say different sources from where the finance could be raised. Of course, it depends on the needs of the company also and their objectives as to whether they want to go with only equity, whether only preference, whether only debt, or they want to make combinations such as equity plus debt, preference plus debt, or they want to have a combined picture of all the three, that is equity, preference, as well as the borrowed funds, that is to say debt. We are definitely going to study each and every pattern in the lectures to come. Of course, not today, but you should know what could be the different sources of finance for any business organization. It completely depends on the business, whether it wants to go for more equity or wants to go for more borrowed funds, whether it wants to have a simple capital structure or a complicated one. It is all based on the needs of the business enterprise. So after having understood with the meaning of capital structure, today we shall be discussing one new topic about the same. That is to say, we are going to discuss about the different characteristics of an ideal capital structure. We discussed about what do you mean by capital structure. But as I said, capital structure is different for different business organizations. It all depends upon their needs and their objectives. But how should be an ideal capital structure? What are the features? What are the characteristics of an optimal capital structure? We shall be discussing today. So let us understand the characteristics of ideal capital structure one by one. This is something which is ideal, which should be implemented in the business organizations. So it brings us to the first characteristic, that is to say, simplicity. A capital structure has to be simple in its nature. When I say simple, a simple capital structure would be easy to manage as well. As I said, a capital structure can include n number of securities. But when you want to have a simple capital structure, it should be the one which includes few number of securities, lesser number of securities. If you have raised finance from number of securities, you make your capital structure quite complex and complicated. On the other hand, when you have raised money from few sources, few securities, it will have you enough scope to raise additional funds from outside even in the near future. Let me give you a simple example. If the company has already raised number of amount, huge amount already from the borrowed funds, could be from debentures or could be a loan taken from bank, the scope of raising further funds from outside would be reduced. On the other hand, when the capital structure is such, which includes few securities, more of owner's funds rather than borrowed funds, it will definitely impact the prestige of the company and also help it raise the finance in future in case the need arises. Also, if the capital structure is quite complicated, it can also raise doubts and suspicion in the mind of prospective investors as well. Those investors who wish to invest in your business in future, they would definitely see the capital structure before they invest their hard-earned money. A simple structure, a structure with few securities, would definitely attract them to invest more. The second characteristic of an ideal capital structure is nothing but balance. Now, when I say balance, a capital structure is balanced if different type of securities are held in correct proportion. Now, of course, there is no such correct proportion for every security in a business, because the ratio between the shares and the preference shares or the debentures depends upon the nature of business. What the nature of business is, what are the needs of the business, it decides whether more funds should be raised from the owned securities or from the borrowed sector. Generally, it is said that the ownership fund should be more than the borrowed funds, because borrowed funds always have a liability of paying fixed interest or fixed dividend respectively. So it is generally said that the ideal debt equity ratio is 2:1, where the ownership capital should be at least twice the borrowed capital. So of course, a balance should be maintained in such a manner between both the type of securities. It should not be such that company has indulged already into huge amount of borrowed funds, because in that case, it will result into impacting the financial condition of the business and will also affect the scope of raising more funds from outside. Number three, it talks about liquidity. Now, when I say liquidity, it was having sufficient cash on hand so as to meet the liabilities in future. When I say liquidity, the financial condition should be such that the company is able to meet with its liabilities, current liabilities, as and when they arise. Capital structure has to be such that grants provides enough liquidity, adequate liquidity to the business so that it can meet with the current liabilities whenever they occur. It will also help to maintain the prestige and thereby would strengthen the credit standing of the company as well. and thereby it also attracts the investors to invest in your company. The company enjoys good goodwill and creditworthiness. So definitely an ideal capital structure has to be the one which grants sufficient liquidity to the business as a whole. The next that you see, capital structure, an ideal capital structure has to be flexible. Now, what do we mean by flexibility? Capital structure that changes with the changing business requirement is something that is flexible. When I say changing requirement, it may sometimes happen that business is now not in need of more finance. Rather, it is suffering from a situation of overcapitalization. So capital structure should leave a scope of even redeeming the shares, redeeming the amount taken from debentures and so on. On the other hand, in case the company or business suffers from shortage of capital, even then there should be a scope of raising the necessary finance from various type of securities. So definitely a capital structure, an ideal capital structure has to be such that grants flexibility so that both increase and decrease in the proportion of various types of securities should be possible whenever the need arises. Let me give you a simple example. Let us say during depression, if the capital requirements have gone down, the company has enough capital and now it is not of much requirement, it should be possible to redeem such preference shares or redeem such debentures at the end of a fixed term. So that sort of flexibility should be imparted by a capital structure. It should not be something that suffers from rigidity. Thereby, number five, it talks about providing a provision against contingencies. Now, what do you mean by contingency? Contingency could be any sort of uncertain event. It may happen in future, it may not happen in future as well. There could be a court case lying against the company, which the company may win or may lose as well. There could be some debtors who fail to pay the money in future, so resulting into a contingency of that debt. Capital structure has to be such which helps the business maintain a provision against such contingencies or against such unforeseen events in future. The capital should be such that funds can be easily raised and provided even in the times of contingencies. So an ideal capital structure has also to make provision for such uncertain or unforeseen events. The next, a capital structure has to be devised in such a manner that it is economical. When I say economical, it is basically showing you the core of financial management, that the funds, the capital has to be raised from the most economical source. We have discussed from the very first lecture that capital is raised at a cost. So when I say capital structure has to be economical, it means to say that enough finance should be available at the right time, but at a minimum cost. We all know that debentures have an obligation of payment of fixed interest, preference shares have an obligation of payment of fixed dividend, and even equity shares needs to be paid dividend in case surplus is left over. So a business enterprise has to be very cautious when it is deciding the type of securities. In case the earnings are quite unstable, the earnings are very irregular, it should not increase its financial burden by raising money from debentures or preference shares. Rather, it should go for the equity shares. On the other hand, if it feels that the interest rates are going down as compared to the rate of dividend, it should go for the borrowed funds like debentures or taking a bank loan. So whatever the case may be, a capital structure should be such and should be devised in such a manner that the capital raised is in the most economic manner. The capital is raised at the most minimum cost. On the other hand, there is an optimum utilization being made for the same. Number seven, an ideal capital structure is the one which is the most consistent. When I say consistent, we are talking about consistency with the objectives. Now, there could be two types of objectives as we have already studied in the previous chapters. It could be a long-term objective and it could be a short-term objective. Long-term objective meaning to say the fixed capital requirements, the requirement of capital for purchasing fixed assets, On the other hand, it could also be the working capital requirements, that is to say, the money required to meet with the day-to-day expenses, day-to-day operations of the business unit. So in even that sense, the capital structure has to be one which is consistent with the objectives of the company, whether the working capital or the fixed capital objectives. That is to say, whether long-term or the short-term objectives. And lastly, a capital structure has to be sound, meaning to say the capital structure should provide enough finance to meet with the obligations as and when they arise. A correct estimate of cash inflow and outflow has to be maintained. It should not be a situation wherein the money is not available to pay off the liabilities of interest or dividend. So a capital structure has to provide that soundness, financial soundness to the business enterprise. So I hope that you are clear with all the different characteristics of an ideal capital structure. I can basically say that the features of an ideal capital structure are quite general in nature. But what is important is that the management has to evolve a particular capital structure which takes into account different factors such as the nature and the size of a business. It could be the capital requirement, it could be the age of business, could be the credit standing, could be the stage of business cycle, and any other factor that keeps on changing. So based on such factors, based on the needs of the business enterprise, an ideal capital structure has to be framed. Of course, should comprise the above characteristics as well. So I hope that you are clear with what we have discussed today. I give you 10 seconds. You can have a quick look at all the different points that you have discussed. That is to say, a capital structure has to be simple, with few securities, not the one with number of securities making it complex and complicated. Should impart a balance between the type of securities and its proportion. That is to say, balance between the ownership fund and the borrowed funds. It should be liquid, providing enough liquidity to meet with the liabilities as and when they arise. Current liabilities should be flexible, that is to help increase, also decrease the capital if required. The one which provides against the contingencies, helps you meet the unforeseen events. The one which is economical. The one which is consistent with the goals of the company, whether long-term or short-term. And the one which also imparts financial soundness to the business organization. I think this much would be enough for today. In the next lecture that we shall be conducting, I would be explaining you about different factors affecting capital structure. You have already done factors affecting a financial plan. So in the next lecture, we would also be discussing how the factors affect capital structure, how they would determine whether funds would be raised from equity or whether it would be raised from preference shares or debentures respectively. So have a quick look at whatever you have studied today. We have been studying the fourth chapter of unit number one that talks all about financial management's capital structure. We have seen how the capital structure looks like, what is the meaning of capital structure, the proportion of different securities in the total capital of a business. Could be equity, could be preference, could be debt, or could be any other source. So if I can say in simple words, it was nothing but the makeup of capitalization, the type of securities and the proportion of each type in the total capitalization. It was nothing but capital structure. So students, this was all for today. We have started with the fourth chapter, that is capital structure. We have understood with the meaning of capital structure, the concept, and we have understood with the characteristics of an ideal capital structure. So see you soon in the next lecture, where we would understand the different factors affecting capital structure. If you have any doubts pertaining to what you have studied, any queries, feel free to post them in the Google Classroom, and I shall be answering to them at the earliest. Keep reading, as the notes have already been provided to you in the Google Classroom. Start reading the chapters we have already discussed and bring up your doubts, if any. Thank you so much for the day. See you soon in the next lecture. Until then, happy learning.